plowing snow because of that. So these are the manpower constraints that we're working with, and it's very difficult. You have people on vacation in the summertime, and we have a number of operators that have some time in, and they're up in the 3 and 4 week vacation bracket. And during the summer months, when there's two men on vacation, and there's one at the transfer station chipping brush, and one assisting with mowing lawns at the Parks Department, it only leaves us with two people really to accomplish work sometimes, and it's very, very difficult. So I'm not fighting, I'm fighting for the position. I'm not going to the extent of the police chief, I guess, but I guess I want to express my concerns that I'm not happy with it and leave it there. We have increased the hourly rate for mechanics charges from $15 to $18 per hour. That's the other change too from last year. And that is the charge that we charge other departments for us to work on their vehicles. Does anybody have any questions?
Does that cover your cost?
Yes, it does.
Bob, just for a moment, you know, I know you're not supposed to ask questions you already have the answer to, but with respect to this position and with respect to your current proposed budget, is there anywhere that you can find that money within the current budget as presented to us to not lose that position?
I would say not right now. I mean, to be perfectly honest with you, something else would have to go. You know, if there was additional capital outlay, I could say yes, we could eliminate that, but there really isn't any fat in this budget at all.
Thank you.
I would just like to say that you don't think that you could give some thought to get back to something they used to do years ago. In the wintertime, they hired somebody part-time in the winter. In the summertime, they hired some school, college kids, students to come in and fill those extra rooms like you're speaking about more and more, and getting away from having the full-time employees. Like a winter like this, you must have quite a job to find something for them to do. The storms are few and far between. And I think it gets costly for the town to operate that way. You could probably come in with a scenario to hire 3 or 4 full-time due to your vacations in the summer and have everybody there at the same time. And it's getting so costly now to have an employee due to the benefits that go. It's up around 30-35%, I think, of benefits to have an employee on board. I think we've got to start looking in other directions here, and you wouldn't have the benefits for the part-timers. And you called me up this last storm, you wouldn't have to get in the truck.
Go ahead.
No,
yeah, I think you have to have some continuity in your program, and I think, you know, relying on part-time people is helpful, but in the summertime, you know, we do jobs that require some experience, and it's not just a matter of hiring a college kid to come in and get in a truck and drive. I think, you know, what we do sometimes is technical work and storm drain and installations and operating our equipment, and we have some very expensive equipment which you need to be trained to operate on, and you just can't bring someone in for a summer and expect them to carry that weight. And in the wintertime, yes, we did used to hire an individual to work in the winter months. He was an experienced individual. He used to work inside and outside, but I don't know, I'd have to give it some thought, but I would have some strong concerns in returning back to that type of system. And I think the part-time people that they used to have years ago in the summertime, that was when they used to sweep the streets by hand in some cases, and that's what these individuals were doing. So we're getting more technical in our work, and it's not just a matter of laboring. You know, there's equipment operation, and you know, running a street sweeper or a backhoe takes experience to do that. And you just don't bring someone in off the street and expect them to do it for 3 months and then go back to school.
Bob, you commented that we have several employees who have 3 to 4 weeks vacation. And the summer months are the busiest time for your department. Mm-hmm. Do you have any sort of rule like they do in business where during the prime busy season of the summer, they're only allowed to take 2 weeks during a certain four-month period, and then others have to be taken in a quieter time of year?
Yeah, we have a number of regulations concerning vacations, and it's really, the wintertime is really what we're geared for, and the men can take winter vacations, but it's only one person can go at a time, and that's for 1 week. And it's something that we've tried on an experimental basis that really hasn't been truly tested yet. So as a result, they're really limited to taking vacations from, say, June, July, August, and somewhat September. So as a result of that, we don't allow more than two equipment operators off at any one time. And this helps to keep, you know, some type of continuity of personnel there. But we do have restrictions on that. And again, the month of July is really a lost month. You know, July is a very popular vacation month, and when all 4 weeks are tied up, losing two people for each week, you know, it becomes very difficult. But we do have restrictions, and you know, they are followed. So you just can't let everybody go at the same time,
yeah,
obviously.
Following up on Billy's idea, I would think that in the summer months, if we offered some sort of training program, if we hired a student just starting college and with the potential of having that person for 3 or 4 summers, that it might be something that's worth investigating. And I know the private sector is different, but in a lot of areas of the private sector, they do that now, truck drivers, et cetera. They are hiring some students, college students, to do that in the summer, because it does save tremendously on the college. And those kids are happy to have those jobs summer after summer. You might have to be up there looking at it.
The other thing to consider is that, you know, to drive our most of our equipment, you really need a truck driver's license, and by the time they get that license, they really, you know, most of our trucks are dump trucks. We have a few pickups, but to do the majority of the work, these men are in dump trucks, and you need what they call Class B license to do that, and it involves a written test or road test. And, you know, if you brought someone on, by the time they got that license and were familiar with the equipment, it may be time to go back to school again. And again, it's, you just
but
don't
get. They knew they were going to do it for.
If,
could do it for 3 or 4
but that's if they worked out.
The other concern, Jane, is that we have pretty good training programs for our personnel, particularly in the area of safety. And with one of our guys about a month or so ago was operating a chainsaw, and he had on him one of these
chaps.
And you know, you have a summer kid. You know, it doesn't hit them. They haven't seen the program. This kid might have lost. This kid, one of our workers, he's one of the younger workers, might have lost his leg. But, you know, he had been to the training program, knew the importance of keeping that equipment on. You could see a big slit right through it. It was, you know, just about cut in two. Instead of that, it could have been the leg. And you know, I think it's nice to say that it'd be good to get these other folks in, but I think, you know, I think people tend to look at public works, and, you know, that's public works. They, you know, drive up and down the street and plow snow, and it doesn't seem too difficult to do. The reality of public works today is it's a lot more than just that, and we do need a well-trained workforce that's particularly conscious of safety. As I look at our safety record in public works, like I gave you those sheets, the last one, the ones we received, it's an excellent, excellent record, and I hate to think of putting people out in that heavy equipment and you know, in dangerous situations when they haven't had the proper safety training, and you can't accomplish that in a week or two.
Yes, but let me add to that. If you had a college student there and the foreman should have made sure that he would be properly equipped with the use of that chainsaw, he shouldn't have to be left up to the individual all the time. So I can make an argument.
I was going to say, I'm going to go along with Bob, especially because when I hire part-timers to help me, no matter how long you train them, they just don't have a sense of respect for the equipment just the same. And I think another thing, Bob alluded to it, is he needs the help also in the winter. So a college kid during the summer isn't going to help him in the winter. I think that one of the solutions would be a compromise between the police department needs someone to change a light bulb, Bob needs someone to plow snow and mow lawns. The school department probably needs someone to help them take trash to the dump. You know, that's where the one-town concept that everyone keeps suggesting and everything makes a little bit of sense here. If you can take from everyone's budget and say, okay, we can take a full-time person now, and he can be training the equipment, he can do this. He can mow the lawns of the school and know what's going on the outside of the building. Reliance on part-timers in certain circumstances, yes, but I mean, I can cite an example where it ruined a $2,000 piece of equipment one time out. And that, and the savings in the long run is gone in one shot. True, it could happen to an experienced person too, but the chances are less likely.
I think that's an important point, and I think, you know, respect for our equipment is something that if someone knows they're going to be there till the end of August, they're not going to have the same respect as if they're driving that piece of equipment 52 weeks a year. And they know they're a short timer, and again, there's no guarantee that they would be coming back. We have part-time people in the summertime that work in the parks division, and my understanding with them is that if you work out, you can come back next year, but it's my choice and not yours. And you know, you could have extremely high rates of turnover if you didn't get someone that worked out.
I think I'd like to suggest, I think it's very, very good discussion. I'm always amazed when I look at the different issues in our different departments, and what the staffing requirements are and some of the particular constraints. The fact in the library, we have almost two separate buildings, even though they're connected. We never want to leave one person alone in a building. And there's all, in public works, the fact we have to haul the transfer trailer three or four times a week, and all of the things that just have to be done all the time. But what I'm getting at is, I think it'd be very helpful if some evening the council could have a workshop that all of the departments were in, and each department had just spent a half hour explaining the numbers of positions they have, what the people do, and sort of an overview of, you know, even the town office, you look and people come in now, why do you get all those people there? You know, not realizing that, you know, they may come in during the middle of the month when it's a little bit quieter, but you need to be geared up for those times. So, you know, if there's any interest, I'd really like to suggest at some time that you have a night where you just get presentations specifically on what is the staffing, how does the police rotation thing work, how many police officers do we have on duty, when is the captain on duty? So you have a much better understanding, because you look at the budget, that's 50% of it. And, you know, maybe not in the context of the budget necessarily, but as you look at staffing overall, you really have a good understanding.
Take 1.5 hours to understand the police rotation.
Perhaps, yeah.
I also think, though, that it is important, as, you know, you were saying earlier, Michael, that basically it can't be business as usual if we're going to make any long-term changes in the bottom line of the budget. So I think we've got to start thinking about doing things differently than the way it's always been done. Even though we've been doing a good job the way we're doing it, I think we have to at least think about other options for running the town.
That's exactly why I think you ought to have that workshop, because I think you ought to understand the base from which we are starting.
But sometimes you then have to buy into that base.
Yeah.
And that puts people into boxes. Well, God, it's always been done this way. And this is, you know, sometimes I think that's good, but I think on the other hand, the benefits of a lay board that hasn't bought into the way things are necessarily being done is that might possibly generate some money.
But I don't see how the lay board can make decisions unless it understands what it is that needs to be done. And that's, you know, I know that's, you know, you can look at what trying to co-opt you and whatever, but, you know, I wouldn't think you'd want to, you know, say this could be cut and then say, oops, you know, we have no way of getting this done. And, you know, I would think you'd want to understand.
I don't think we're going to cut everything so bad that it's going down the tube. I would just like to say one thing. If you're going to do something like that, I would like to have somebody put together some figures for me on what it would cost to contract some of these jobs, somebody coming in and doing some of these jobs, over what it costs us to keep an employee around. A lot of these communities, you know, they like in the wintertime, they hire their roads plowed and what have you. Now, you know, part of it. And they have their own force and then they hire somebody out. And I'd like to have that figured out sometime. whether you keep somebody around waiting for that snowstorm, or you hire somebody in for a few hours.
We can do that, but I think you ought to remember two things. One is that we have had four contractors this year that we've worked with Water Business halfway through the year.
I think there's some around that would be in business.
And secondly, when you have your own workforce, you have a much better control of timing and of quality. And if you're talking about snow plowing and essentially getting rid of our public workforces to do that, I know you say there's this contractor over here, there's this one over here, but those contractors are already doing things during storms, and I think you might be disappointed in the results. And I think the few times we've taken a reduction in snow plowing maintenance and the council has directed it, it was back in the early 80s, they said to cut salt, to cut this. The council was very emphatic on what they wanted, and we went out and did it. The first storm in each instance, the phones rang off the hook, including to councilors and then to me, or to John Henchy. Why weren't we out there? Why didn't we do it? On and on and on. And, I think I can get the memo back out, and it was very simple. It started with the council, and the council said, the council said, you don't need to do this to this level. And, I think when you deal with that and you make those decisions, you've also got to deal with the complaints from it. And in essence, that's the issue in this whole budget, is, we're looking at a budget with an 8% reduction. I agree we ought to look at better ways to find ways to do things, but we've all got to recognize that with fewer dollars, we're not going to be able to do what we're doing now.
Don't bother to do it. You waste your time because you're against it already.
Against so what?
Of looking into the cost of hiring somebody to do something.
I am against contracting out snow plowing services,
so
yes.
Don't waste your time.
Because the council makes that decision. If the council wants to look at it and study it, the council ought to have the information to make that decision.
But why does it have to be snow plowing? Why can't it be the services in the summertime when you've got people on vacation, such as the basic lawn maintenance?
We hire kids to do that, the lawn maintenance, at a pretty good rate.
I think the contracting of services obviously is a very complicated issue. We struggled with this issue with the Cumberland County budget this year. And I think there are certain types of services that lend themselves to lesser problems when you contract them out. I mean, obviously, if we're paying someone $16 an hour to wash a car, when we can get all the cars washed for $100 a year, that would seem a reasonable change. But I think in contracting out, you also then have to look at those intangibles like morale and pride and workmanship and being part of a team. And I think those are always the tough ones to get a bottom line to. And unfortunately, the money is always a bottom line. But I just think those other issues have got to be considered. Rosemary?
I'd like to ask Michael what the policy is for non-union employees for hours worked per week or weeks per year to allow all benefits except statutory benefits.
I'm not sure I understand your question.
How many hours can we hire someone and not pay health, dental, and life?
I didn't bring the personnel policy with me today.
But do we have one? Is it 30?
My belief is it's 35. But then there's also a provision there that if we have two people job sharing one position that the council has created as a full-time position, that those benefits can be done on a pro rata basis.
We offer part-time people a pro rata on limited circumstances.
Not unless they are fulfilling a position that was specifically set up as a job share. If we do have someone that works, in the terms of vacation, if there's someone that works a 52-week a year schedule at 20 hours every week, they do get the proportionate vacation at the 20 hours per week. But not if someone works during the summer alone. They don't get anything. But if they're a year-round employee, even if it's part-time, and they work more than 15 hours per week, they do get the proportionate vacation. and they're not health insurance.
We really probably need to move on a little bit here.
I just want to say one more thing.
Please.
I think there's contractors out there that can dig a ditch and lay a pipe just as well as our employees. That's summer work, as Phyllis just mentioned, when you've got your men on vacation.
Yeah.
Just because we had two contractors that went bankrupt, this was due to the economy and the way things went. Evidently, we hired the wrong contractors, and it wasn't, they weren't looked at thoroughly enough to be able to go on, and we should have hired another one that was a little higher, and he's still in business.
Billy, one of the contractors you have in mind for maybe doing some of this work,
no.
I had a discussion with yesterday. They said, why are you guys bidding out Waterhouse Road? You know, why aren't you doing that yourself? And, you know, because of the fact we're down to two actually working employees because of all the other things that have to be done sometimes, you know, they're doing the little odds and ends. I would like to see us do a lot more project-oriented things so that we don't have to pay the contractors, which end up cost a lot. But we can't even do it with our current personnel. You know, there are things we could contract out. We could contract out dispatching. And every time that's come up, no one's wanted to do it. We could contract out hauling the transfer trailer. We looked at that, and before, and we can look at it again, it was much more expensive to have it hauled rather than do it ourselves. There are a number of specific things like that that we can look at. Snow plowing is one that, I'll stop there.
I had ideas. Jay Gronin in my mind when I was talking.
Yeah, a good outfit.
I don't want to beat a dead horse to death. I think two things that you lose when you contract out in private contracting is something, and public works is becoming more and more popular. But I think you lose flexibility and accountability. And I know if you hire someone to plow a street, they do not take the same pride and care that our own individuals do, for a couple of reasons. One, if we do damage to lawns, we have to go back and fix them in the spring. So the gentleman that plows that route is very careful not to do that damage because he knows he's going to have to go back in the spring and fix it. If you hire someone to do that, he doesn't care about that. He's not going to see that lawn in the spring. He's going to be gone. And I think the decision to go plowing is always a hard decision, and you really have to have your act together when you have contractors waiting, chomping at the bit to plow your streets. You have to give them ample notice to come in, and it causes a lot of problems. And you look at street sweeping. Some towns contract out to have their streets swept. That's fine, but you lose the flexibility of doing it yourself when you want to do it. Right now, we're currently sweeping as a job to pick up the sand and save us a little time later in the spring. But we can do it on my decision and when I want to, and not when a contractor has a sweeper available. So I think, again, you've got to look at flexibility and accountability. Those are two important things. Well, that I will say no more.
Excellent. You need those good discussions.
We do.
Let's roll here.
Part-time payroll reflects a 5% increase, and again, I'd like to repeat that these people are extremely dedicated individuals. I rely on about four or five people to come in, and these people really stand by for us. They could easily say, I'm staying home for Christmas and having Christmas with my family, or I'm going to go away for the weekend, but they are very dedicated and will stay around and stay near the phone and come in when I request them to do so if they're not working. So I think they've traditionally been underpaid, and I like to increase their pay by 5% each year to get them up to a respectable level. So they could easily make more money plowing driveways on their own. So they've opted to help the town out, and I think we should recognize them. Overtime shows a reduction, again, for a couple of reasons. One, the deletion of an equipment operator, and also the transfer of the supervisor from an hourly position to a salary position. And as we go on, I heard some discussion earlier about the estimated expenditures for this fiscal year. This budget was put together back in the first week of January, so a lot of factors have changed. So the figures you see there may or may not reflect the correct amount. So obviously, over time, I don't think we're going to use $35,000 worth if things keep going the way they are. But you have to understand that we have the month of March ahead of us, and you know, you can get a lot of snow in March. But the way this winter's been going, it hasn't reflected that.
Right now, it's $20,342 as of yesterday.
Telephone shows a slight increase there, $100.
I got a question there. Just my own comments. Is that a standard top figure as far as a cellular phone goes?
Cellular?
$250. Do they all use that?
No, it depends on use.
Depends on use.
Different departments use it more than others, depending on a lot of factors.
Last year, I budgeted $200 a year, and it really wasn't enough, so I upped it $50. And most of my calls are during the wintertime, and believe it or not, there's a lot of time and temperature calls and calls to the Weather Bureau, so that's what the majority of the calls are. But I use it as on an emergency basis, and will go back to the office if I have to make long phone calls, because at 75 cents a minute, it's extremely expensive to use.
So the others don't go this high?
My bill was $13 last month.
I'm talking about yours.
They vary considerably, but there is, I'd say they probably range up to about $25 per month.
Do we have any kind of a package deal for your cellular phone, Michael's, or are they just independent accounts?
No, the fire and police chiefs were given their cellular phones by a local vendor as a goodwill type gesture, but Mike and I had to have the town purchase ours or some manner. So we didn't get the same benefit.
Have you ever looked at, a possible two at the same time kind of thing? Is there any
I think there's a move afoot there coming from the Council of Governments to look at the issue of say a joint purchasing of airtime or something like that I just received info on this week, so I'm going to wait to see what they come up with for a program. Power is showing an increase, and that's due to the expansion of the garage addition. Water and sewer is staying the same.
Are you expecting that to be increased because of the expansion?
Yes. Just for the electrical demand. I mean, you're just putting on, you're putting up more.
I'm sorry, I'm on water and sewer.
Oh, okay.
I turned the page.
Oh, excuse me. We're looking at holding that the same. I'm not sure what rates are going to do. They're probably going to go up, I think, but.
Sewer, I'm proposing a 5% increase.
So it does not reflect that.
Does that need to be adjusted?
Yeah.
I agree with Bill.
It'll be a warm.
We get the new batteries, we can't use them because.
It'll be a warm March. We'll have a little fluff in there.
Dues and membership are staying the same. Conferences and meetings. Again, I put down that I was planning to attend the national conference of the American Public Works Association this year. And what my program has always been to go every other year. And this would have been my year to go, but because of the budget. I eliminate it from the budget this year. So that's just for state and local conferences and training for our personnel.
Well, what would you foresee the cost being for you to attend a
About $1,500.
I'd like us to put that on the revisit call. And I think that ties into employee morale, among other things.
Yeah, I've been there before.
Well, I'm very committed to employing really on that.
Equipment rental being kept the same. Uniform rental is actually showing a reduction again because of one less person. And we are going to be able to hold the line on these costs for 3 years, which I think is extremely helpful.
That's a great cost.
Yeah. Equipment maintenance, normally I like to increase that by about 2-3% a year just to cover inflation and additional parts costs, but we're trying to hold the line on that. Radio maintenance, again the same. Building repair and maintenance, the same. Storm drain cleaning, I tried to hold the line on that, and I reduced the number of hours from last year slightly. So I think we can, again, and this account is based on what you have for winter. And if you have an extremely high winter where you're using a lot of sand, you're going to have more time to clean your basins. This year we're not using quite as much sand, so it probably will take us a little bit shorter time to do the work. But again, we've still got another month to go here, so a lot can change.
Do we rent a machine for that?
What we do, we bid this out through the Council of Governments, and there's usually three or four bids that come in, and they work in Cumberland County for all the towns.
So we contract up both the machine and the operator?
Exactly. We do send one of our operators with the truck to show them the locations of the basins. So they know where they're going. So. Pavement markings, holding the line on that. Curbing maintenance, you probably don't have an estimated expenditure in there. Again, I don't foresee us going over the 3,000 because most of that comes from damaged curbing from snow plowing. So we haven't had too many instances of that this year, so I don't foresee. We probably won't even use probably more than 1,500 in that account. Road resurfacing, that is reflecting a 50% drop from last year, and again, because of the budget constraints, one of the areas that we felt to try to gain some cuts and some extra income was to reduce that by $20,000. So it's not something that we like to do. You know, if you don't keep up a regular maintenance program, whether it be vehicles or pavement or anything, at some point you're going to have to put more dollars into that. You can always get by that one more year, but it's something that's either pay now or pay later.
Where do we stand in our basic overall repainting plan? Have we been cutting back periodically from one year to another?
No, we haven't. There was,
so we've been right up to your
yeah, I think
budget.
There was about five,
10 years ago.
6 years ago, we reduced it by half.
It was a big cut.
And it really, you know, we really felt the results of that cutting and brought it back up to the $50,000 level and maintained it there for a couple of years. But when you get down to $20,000, you really don't get much tonnage out of that.
When I first came here in 1978, I think we were budgeting $55,000 a year for road resurfacing. And since that time, you know, the price per the price per ton is probably more than doubled, and this year's budget has $20,000 in it. So you can see this year's budget, we're doing one-fifth the effort. I should also mention that we do have the account later on that you have the capital improvement account. Back then, we were raising money for that that sort of matched the state program. It's called the state aid program. But what happened is we put funds in, the state matched it. So, you know, if you add together both programs, we're still probably only doing about, in real terms, about half of what we were doing at the end of the 70s. So it's...
So we've not really caught up to that original cut way back.
We were just about catching up to it, particularly because you occasionally stepped aside and also did some projects that were bonded. That helped. The Sawyer Road one in particular helped out.
One thing that has helped us in the last couple of years, asphalt prices have been down. So, say, about 6 or 8 years ago, we were paying, say, $24 to $25 a ton of paving. This year, we were at $22. So they are, you know, anticipating a modest increase this coming year, but the tonnage prices have gone down slightly.
Now, that's all contracted. They haul it. You don't haul it.
No, we don't. We used to haul our own when there was a plant located on Pleasant Hill Road, but right now it really is more cost effective if they do the hauling.
We looked at that at one point, Billy. I think the last year we hauled, they gave us a differential of like a dollar per ton, or some even lesser amount than that. We figured out for every time our truck ran to the plant. This was back when I think it was over on Bishop Street. Somewhere over that way we were going. It was $6 a truckload we were saving by driving one of our trucks without our men on it all the way from here to Portland and back, and it just didn't pay. And then, you know, the cleaning of the trucks and the wear and tear and everything else. We found the time. In that case, the contracting out was very advantageous.
I can see that, so look at the
one.
I didn't pay
for this one.
I think with road resurfacing, you know, Mike brought up a good point that when private contractors haul the mix, they have larger trucks than we have. They have, you know, tandem axle trucks that can haul twice as much as our dump trucks can. Some of the trucks are equipped with heated bodies, so the mix stays hotter. They have covers on them so the next will stay hotter. So they're really geared for doing this home. We're really not. So.
I'm just concerned that we're cutting
it
that much.
So am I. Yeah. I'd like to see $80,000 there, but it's just not possible.
Do we want to revisit this account?
Yes.
I share Phyllis's concern, and I see this is something we're going to get ourselves into a bonding issue eventually if we keep cutting like this between this and the road reconstruction.
If you can do $50,000 a year, that's a good program to keep up with your maintenance. And that's just a maintenance overlay, you know, let's say an inch to an inch and a quarter.
But the roads out there now, there a lot of them are really a mess with the frost. Throughout this whole year.
Yeah, they're terrible. Yeah.
But yeah, this last year.
The repaving won't help the frost.
On Sawyer Road, it really helped in a few others. But you look at just coming up the hill here on Route 77 now, it opened out last year when we had the warm winter, and this year it's even worse. We've got to hope for a good cold winter at some point to get the roads back into good shape.
Yeah.
Stay cold.
Contingency remains the same. Office supplies the same. Gasoline the same. And we reduced the number of gallons that we're anticipating using because we increased the price per gallon up to 90 cents from 80 cents this year.
What are we paying now?
Roughly right around 77 cents a gallon. It's been up and down with the Persian Gulf crisis, so we were up as high as $1.13 at one point. But we're back down to a good level now. Heat, again, shows an increase due to the additional heating oil usage that we're anticipating in the new addition. Minor equipment and tools being kept the same. Miscellaneous supplies the same. Gravel, showing a reduction in that because when we did the Spurwink Avenue road project, we reclaimed a lot of the asphalt and gravel material and basically planed off about 3 or 4 inches of gravel on that road, and we kept that gravel. So we're using that in our excavation operations, so we therefore don't have to buy as much crushed gravel from local pits. So,
Bob, how at such a time when the Highlands development takes place and this whole gravel road versus surface road issue is a reality, do you have any estimate how much that is going to cost us each year to take care of that stretch?
I don't know if we're looking at any additional cost. I mean, you're looking at probably a load of gravel here or a load of gravel there, but the problem is the type of maintenance that you have to do. You've got to grade the road, and then if you have to plow at this time of year where you have freeze-thaw cycle, it's very difficult to plow a gravel road, say in March. If it's paved, obviously you can plow at any time of the year and not have any problems, but you have to do it with a particular type of plow. It can't be a plow that doesn't have shoes. It has to be able to ride on the gravel surface, so it creates a whole host of problems and inconveniences.
We would have to rent that equipment?
No, we have all that equipment.
We do have it.
Yeah.
Okay. And this, we have the equipment to grade it?
That's right, we have a grader.
We have a 1967 grader. Is that the year?
1970.
70? What's that new?
Oh, that's pretty
good. Youngster. We don't have any plans to ever replace that grader, so.
We'll have a talk later, Mike.
We don't have any plans to replace the grader. That's the perfect example of something that we need so little that we would contract out before we buy a new grader.
The problem with the grader is a new grader is basically going to cost $100,000. The problem with contracting out for a grader, and the time you really need that grader is during an ice storm or a snowstorm. You have to peel off large amounts of snowpack ice. And the problem is that when you have to do that, everybody else wants to rent a grader too, and they're in short supply. So,
just maybe the keep that in mind. Will reimburse us.
Keep that in mind as you think about graders.
I'm talking about the state.
Sam,
requesting to keep the same amount of dollar amount as last year. Again, we haven't used as much sand as we would in a normal winter, but we're not out of the woods yet, and we still have a 30 days to go, at least.
You're anticipating a carryover, then?
Oh, yes, definitely. Salt, holding the line there. Again, it's always a controversial account, but it's one of those necessary evils of winter road maintenance.
How much have we used so far this year?
I want to say that we've probably expended... Do you have everything? Like, I'm just kind of make a guess, so... That's not including the bills you had from the...
Yeah, I was going to answer that. About 19,000. 19 to 20. We do fill our salt shed after every storm, so it's always filled.
Yeah, but you've got into that, so it doesn't affect...
That's right.
The figures here.
That's right.
It was full when you started, so it's full when you get down.
Right.
We also use it to mix in with the sand.
I noticed this year, is it the equipment we got, or is it the help that's using? It seems like there's a lot screwed on the commons that stays there for a few days. What is the problem?
Well, I mean, there really isn't a problem, but we've spoken and cautioned the operators to be careful at intersections. The problem comes is when you're slowing down to an intersection, the truck's hydraulics are slowing down because of engine RPMs, and the spinner that applies the salt is slowing down, so instead of spreading the salt out, it's basically dropping on the ground. So unless they come to an intersection with the transmission in neutral and 1 foot on the gas and 1 foot on the brake, which is common practice, that it's very hard to avoid that. So, and you just can't roll through intersections either. You have to stop. But you do. You have to watch those controls, and you know, having been in the trucks before, you have to be careful of those things. But I think there's an issue of say when we salt and when we don't salt, and I think it's awful easy to pass judgment on the next morning as to why we did what we did. And I know when you wake up and you see the roads white, you're questioning, you know, why that was done. But the last particular storm, everybody was in the same boat. South Portland roads were white, Portland, Scarborough, and the sun came out, warmed things up, and the residual salt was left over.
But the part I was looking at, and whether we need to make some changes, is so we wouldn't have to have those streams that's left on the road there for a day or so afterwards on all the intersections.
Again, I think it's a combination of the operators have to be careful and watch the controls. And the other thing to remember is that, you know, you may not agree with this, but you know, we call that residual salt. And that salt is there for the next storm. It doesn't really go away. And it may buy you some time on the next storm that you don't have to come out quite so quickly, the salt, because the salt is left over from the last storm.
But don't buy me any time on my vehicle as I pick it up.
No. But it doesn't stick like it would if it had water or snow mixed in with it.
One thing we have noticed this year have been helped a little bit is where they fixed up Route 77, we're able to melt the snow and ice there a lot easier than we were in the past, because the sun's able to get at it. The clearing they did, as well as we can plow it fairly flat and get most of the meal off with the plow instead of the snow.
I think one thing to remember too is that when we saw, unlike South Portland, that we saw what we call one lane or middle lane salting, and we apply salt down the middle of the road. Route 77 could easily and justifiably be salted in both lanes. If you come into South Portland in the morning when they've been salting, you'll see there's black pavement from curb to curb. And you know, I just can't afford to salt like that. I wish I could, but when you come into Cape from South Portland, you'll see that the road is closed right in, and there's a little black strip about 3 or 4 feet wide on the yellow line. And that's because, you know, we're making one pass and they're making two. There are times when we have to do that to clear the road, but the salt account would double if we did that on most of our roads.
And Bob, that's why some of South Portland roads are white in the mornings from the salt.
That's right.
Well, they got the box.
I don't know about that.
Next.
Patch. I guess patch is being maintained at the same level. There's no request for snow fence and guardrail, though I would like to someday replace the guardrail at the corner of Old Fort and Oxley Road, but
I'm stuck asking you.
I'll hold it in abeyance until times get better, I guess.
We'll contract it in.
There you go. Sign material being kept the same. Sidewalks, I am proposing a reduction in that account. And again, because of budget constraints, we were doing about $10,000 worth of replacement work in the shorefront area to try to hold the line on the overall picture of the budget. I reduced it by $8,000 to just strictly emergency repairs or maintenance.
I spoke with the city manager of South Fulton yesterday afternoon. He said that you and the director of public works are again looking at Stillman.
Yes.
South Fulton has approached us. You remember that a few years ago we had an issue about the school bus, and there's a real problem with kids waiting around there. It's so narrow, and particularly on the South Fulton end, they built some homes, and there are an awful lot of new homes. There's an awful lot of homes. It happens that most of that section of Stillman is actually in Cape Elizabeth, so what we're doing is working with South Fulton. It's probably a joint crew effort to put in a sidewalk along the right side of, as you're heading towards Cape Elizabeth, on Stillman. So if you see some activity going on over there, that's what it is. But it'll be a joint project of the two communities. It mostly benefits South Portland residents, but looking at their problem, we can see that they do have a problem, and that most of the sidewalk, unfortunately, has to go on Cape Elizabeth.
Storm drain material, again, holding the line there. Diesel fuel showing a slight reduction. I've reduced the number of gallons that we are anticipating using. Capital outlay, again, normally there would be a dump truck in here, and other items, again, they've been eliminated. And what we have left is with just minor capital purchases. The first purchase of them, I'd like to propose is what they call a modular soil support system, or trench shoring. The OSHA regulators now are clamping down. It used to be you could dig a ditch, and if you had personnel in it, you didn't need any type of protection for the trench. It's just not the case anymore, and if they come on a job and you have a man in a trench and it's over his head, they can cite you and fine you a considerable sum. It's just not worth taking the chance, and really, based on their regulations, we really should have something like that at our disposal and be ready to use it. Radio system modifications. We've had a tremendous problem with getting outside interference on our radio frequency. It's getting so bad that their signals are overpowering our own and our own dump trucks, and you really, a lot of the fellows, we're on them quite often, but they end up turning the radio down just so they don't have to listen to the outside interference. So we have to make some modifications to our system to eliminate that outside interference. So that's what the $1,500 request is for. And finally, the third request is to replace a snowblower attachment that goes on one of our lawnmowers, and we use that again to clear sidewalks and parking areas and skating ponds in the wintertime.
Can you say the present was 14
years old? Yes, and we have to spend a lot of time doing maintenance on it, and it seems this past year that every time it's gone out, it's had to come back in again for repairs. So.
I know you said it has served the town well. I assume he had appreciated that comment.
I hope so.
Reached the end, but used the luck.
Well, I think you have skating ponds on a regular location.
Yes, they are. We try to get on them as quickly as possible. Obviously, we don't spend money on overtime cleaning them off. You know, if we have a storm on a Friday night, we don't bring someone in on a Saturday morning to clean them off. If it's during the regular work week and we have a storm, we'll start right on them first thing in the morning. But a lot of it depends on ice conditions, if we can get on it at all. And I think you've seen in the paper or the news recently that you have to be very careful when you're on these ponds. But we do try to make a good effort to get on them as soon as possible. And we have had some private help, some very dedicated individuals that have been helping us clear the ponds. So we know there's a lot of interest in skating. I like to skate myself, so it's a high priority.
Particularly against the weekends.
Exactly. But we do get calls. We do get calls if we have a Friday night storm and they're untouched until Monday morning.
But we don't budget for it.
One of the pieces of equipment that you have decided not to purchase this year is a personal computer to help update all your records.
Right.
How extensive is your record system?
It's really quite extensive. We keep records on on all our equipment, not just ours, but fire department equipment and police cruisers. So we keep track of labor hours and material costs spent on those vehicles on a monthly basis. And it really shows us, it gives me a good indication of how much a piece of equipment is costing us. And I know last year I provided you some information when we purchased the loader of a year-by-year breakdown of the number of labor hours that we put in and the material costs. And at some point you look at that and that piece of equipment is costing you a lot of money. Those are the type of records that I would like to see on a computer. And
why can't we add this to our wish list?
It's on mine.
It's on mine.
You mean for a volunteer to?
For someone to donate a personal computer to the Public Works Department.
Do you have a system in mind?
No, I don't. We were looking at an IBM PC, but beyond that.
IBM compatible?
Yeah.
One thing I've been looking at, I don't even think I've mentioned it to Bob yet, is certainly I should mention to the council after the discussion we had a month or so ago, but I was hoping that maybe we could address this in the furnishings section of the garage if the bids come in well. But that would be on the list that would be reviewed by the council.
It would be nice if it could be donated.
Usually Public Works, you know, PC, it's not... People like to donate things you can put a plaque on or that they can...
Well, we can do that.
for a computer, we would do that, Michael.
Yeah.
In the long range.
So you want his own personal computer, you don't want it to tie in?
No. What would be nice to see is actually two PCs over there, one for the clerk and one for Bob, that could be somewhat tied in. And PCs themselves aren't that expensive. It's
really the software.
It's the software. And
I think you're looking at about $2,000, something roughly, yeah, for a PC.
Yeah.
But with the software,
software
looking
is
at
additional money.
$4,500
to $5,000. Exactly.
Right. I know that was one thing on my list. I'm glad Phyllis brought it up. That was one of the, I don't know if that was in one of the seminars I attended at National League of Cities or just picked up some information. I didn't talk to you, and I'm kicking myself. Now I've got on my list to talk to the Public Works Director in South Portland about computerizing the maintenance records and all. But I like the point you brought up, that you deal also with the fire department vehicles and the police department vehicles, and if all of those can be on the same computer program. So you do have a very good record of your maintenance program. I think it's very helpful. I really, you know, think this is something that I would, you know, if we can find any extra money, this is something that I would like to have included for you, either through the, that's right, it's on the list, in the new construction that we do, if the bids come in to our favor, or to say that this is something we'll revisit now. It'd be great if we could get the hardware donated by somebody. We still need the software to make this a worthwhile venture.
Right. We also need a printer. It doesn't do any good to input without the printer.
On and on.
So we're talking about how many dollars?
And then Bob said 5,000, and I'm not...
That was just for one, too.
Yeah, he wasn't... Yeah. I think I took him by surprise, the clerk, but I can't see... I think the clerk ought to have one in there to be input. You know, Bob shouldn't have to be inputting all that data. He had the clerk do it.
Well, then you could still probably get by with one.
We could get by with one, but I've always taken the position with computers, when you set up the system, you ought to set it up the way you're going to use it and set it up right, or else what happens is you've made a decision and then you find out things don't fit together, they're not compatible, and you get yourselves all messed up.
You only have to buy the software once.
Yeah,
that's true. Yes, true. But wasn't there some sort of program years ago when the schools were expanding their computer systems? Was it possible for us to be part of that bid to obtain some extra computers, or is that still in existence? Or?
It's not so much extra computers, but there's a program that originally started through COG, but it's not really there anymore, also on the side, that's with Apple.
With Apple.
And it gives a very, very healthy discount, but not free equipment, but a very, very healthy discount.
Well, is that something that we be eligible for?
Oh, yeah, we do participate in it. The printer that we replaced in my office recently, Marty Watts did all the work and the negotiating and everything else for it. He's the computer person.
It's something we really should investigate a little more thoroughly.
Continue to investigate. We haven't investigated a whole lot lately because it's not in the budget. There wasn't a reason to investigate it.
does it, now with the mechanic, you can compute it, you can see what he does on the vehicle, or are you going to write it down and somebody else can?
He'd write it down and the clerk would process the information.
Which is what he does now, and sticks it in the folder.
Right? Right.
So he's already got to write it down and then put it into a folder. And I'm not against computers, I think computers are good, but I see the 400,000 bond issue that it's growing every day.
Any other questions for Mr. Malley? Rosemary?
No, I just want to make a comment on this. This was on my list of things to revisit, but if it's going to be revisited in the building itself, fine. I do not think that that is something that he should have to go without if there's any way to find funding for it, because the efficiency of it will pay for itself very, very quickly.
Other comments? Bob, do you want to make a closing statement?
Not really. We have one more account to deal with here, roadway and drainage improvements. I'll defer to the manager on his memo.
I gave you an outline of where this account stands. Actually, a sheet explaining it. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer your question. Basically, proposing a reduction in a little more than 50% cut from $153,500 down to $75,000. One issue we have here is within the roadway improvement plan, you have a whole long list of projects, and something is going to have to give at some point. And what I suggest here is that you ought to take a studious look at the cost and benefits of the Shore Road Shoulder Improvement Project. You can interpret that how you wish. I think in times of when we're not going to be able to maintain the existing roads as much as we should, as much as we need to, you look at Oakhurst Road and some of the problems that are happening there, I think, when this next comes up to you for a policy consideration as to what project next goes ahead, I think you ought to take a look at the Shore Road Shoulder Improvement project and really define what it is that you want, because there are a number of areas we could do shoulder improvements, particularly in areas that don't affect individual property owners. In that curvy section there, there's a lot we could do without impacting trees, without impacting front lawns, all of that. There are other areas that are a lot more difficult to do because of environmental aesthetic considerations. And at some point, maybe at a workshop, what I'd like to suggest is that you visit that whole area. These are the projects coming up, maybe get a presentation from Bob. What are your priorities, and then we'll move forward on what you indicate your priorities to be. You don't need to debate that necessarily today, but I would hope that you'd fund at least the amount that's indicated here, recognizing that it is a reduction of over 50%.
So we're committed to do that. We can't use those funds somewhere else.
You're not committed to that, no. You're talking about the Shore Road Shoulder Improvement Program?
Yes.
You're not committed to that.
So we could pull on that another year and use some of it for paving streets or something.
If the council voted to do that.
It's legal.
If the council voted to do it.
That's a good question, because that's what I've been asked by a number of people lately. We thought you committed funds to the Shore Road Shoulder Improvement. And I've had a hard time providing a satisfactory answer.
I think what has happened is, and I think last year, is when you funded the Waterhouse Road project, which was the last one, I gave you a report and I said X number was available which could be applied to the Shore Road Shoulder Improvement project. You never formally said, yes, indeed, that's what it is.
I thought we had committed half of the money.
I thought we had committed something definite to Shore Road Shoulder. That's why I get trouble.
Mm-hmm. Some.
That's what last year's budget indicates.
And I think what I'm saying is we could take that money practically now and address some of the areas that don't involve front lawns and those sorts of things. But once we get into front lawns, we're talking about an entirely different project. Not entirely different.
It's a different scope of the project. We've always talked about starting down towards the fort end first because of those reasons, because you're not getting into the more densely developed part of Shore Road. I don't know, but I need to know for myself to be able to answer the questions if we really have dedicated any of this and how much we did. And it still can be a council decision, certainly, if you want to undedicate that. But I think the citizens deserve to know standing of those funds.
Last year was listed to continue Shore Road Children. Is this last year?
Yes. Yeah.
Continue Shore Road Children Improvement, $75,000.
Because we already had $50,000 in.
That was a request. Nothing's been done.
Would you look to see if we had, what stuck in my mind is we had dedicated $50,000 at one
point. You know, I could go out and spend $50,000 right now in engineering.
I just want to know if there's $50,000 dedicated. I don't need to. That's something I need to. Another question I have, I was told the clock could answer this, was what would you foresee the price for the work doing the reclamation of Oakhurst Road?
Okay, that's really not going to be a reclamation project. It's going to be a coal planing process, which is where the road is planed or milled down to restore the crown of the road. We're not really disturbing the subbase at all. We're just planing down the existing asphalt surface. Mm-hmm. And I think we looked at about $80,000 that would cover that project.
Okay. Just going back to the other point, in the budget that Rosemary just showed me, I think last year, in terms of Shore Road Shoulder Improvement, in terms of this whole account, I basically said exactly what I said a few minutes ago, is that the council would revisit all of it and then determine what your priorities are. I think what we need to do is to look back at what actually happened at a council meeting.
Not
with the budget, because when the budget last year, when we sat here on this, whatever date it was, the beginning of April, it was specifically said it would all come back to the council. And so I think what we need to do is look.
It did come back to the council.
And what did the council vote? What's your record?
Voted to dedicate half of the amount necessary for the shoulder improvements, is what I remember.
We need some.
I think I'm hearing you want that to move forward. Is that the message I'm getting?
We want to know.
We want to at least know the status right now.
Yeah, the status
before we make any more decisions about it.
Yeah, the status is nothing's happened already.
But we want to know the status of any dedicated funds.
Right. Did we dedicate a certain number of dollars?
Yeah. I will recheck the record.
I'm sure doing the cover article. I think I wrote that one.
You were.
it was entitled, "One is a Bikeway, Not a Bikeway."
Yeah.
Yes. But don't use that B word.
I just, you know, want to make sure before we move ahead on anything, yes, in fact, the council has given its final vote to this.
Well, let's investigate that.
Yeah. All right, we'll move it. Please. Could you check the council minutes, council records of when they last discussed the Shore Road Shoulder Improvement? It might have been the May meeting of the council.
March.
And see if they actually designated any funds for the Shore Road Shoulder Improvement. Thank you. All right, why don't we move on in the refuse disposal of 320. Check on that.
Full-time payroll is reflecting a 5% increase. And again, on that, you'll see that we take one half of the salary of the sewer solid waste foreman out of that account, and the remaining portion is taken out of full-time sewer payroll because the duties are split between the two. Part-time payroll is reflecting a 5% pay increase, and that's for the individual that fills in for the full-time attendant in his absence. Overtime, it's showing an increase from last year. Last year it was budgeted 110 hours, this year 150 hours. And that's really for the full-time attendant to fill in the absence of the part-time attendant. Rather than bring someone up from the Public Works Department up there, we really like to keep a little bit of continuity in the operation. And it's not just a matter of how to run the equipment, but recognizing individuals and recognizing loads that may be coming in. And a person that's in the highway division may not be so much apt to recognize a problem if it comes in than if someone is there on a regular basis. So we're filling basically the part-time vacation with a full-time.
Bob, you find it worthwhile for us to continue with the being open on 4 Sundays, both spring and fall?
Yeah, it's working out very well. We seem to be getting good response from it. Usually the first In the spring, we don't get as much traffic as we do in the fall, obviously with leaves. And, the residents seem to enjoy it, and they're being very good about just bringing in leaves and other yard waste and not bringing in rubbish, so it seems to work out very well.
And the cleanup weeks, my recollection is we're doing more pickup every cleanup week we have. And I just want to make sure that if we're going to continue that, that we have adequate funding to do so. I think a lot of people are becoming, I know I have become more dependent on that. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a wonderful service. I just want to make sure it's, we're going to have enough funds to do that.
In this particular case, the transportation is normally closed on Tuesdays. And during cleanup weeks, we open it on Tuesdays. Therefore, the full-time attendant works that day for about 9 hours. So that's it. It covers that. Mm-hmm. Telephone is showing a slight reduction just in the monthly charge. The charge for telephone usage hasn't actually gone down, except that our monthly amount was budgeted a little bit too high, so I dropped it down $3 or $4. Power is being kept the same. Water and sewer again is the same as last year. Bail fill service, probably the manager can shed a little bit more light on this, but from some of our discussions with the individuals at RWS, originally they were forecasting, say, a $5 to $10 increase in the tipping fee. Now it's down below $5, and I guess they're still deliberating on what that is going to be. But I thought it's a safe bet that we ought to throw $3 additionally in there just to cover ourselves. I've heard even discussions that they may be able to hold it for this year. But
is it $40?
It's $40 right now.
Do we know where the town manager, what information he had where he was able to knock off about $20,000 in that account?
I think he talked with Charles Boucher, who's the executive director, and I think he got the message from him that they were going to try to hold the line, but they could not guarantee that. So originally I had forecasted a $5 increase, and that's where the reduction came from.
Bob, is there any possibility with massive efforts of the about to be appointed recycling committee that there might be enough taken out of the trash cycle that we might see a significant savings?
Right now it's hard to gauge that because we're really not seeing a significant drop in the tonnage. I mean, it's right now it's actually last month we had 5 more tons than we had from last time at the same time period. And I think it's important to note that in the recycling container right now, there's newspapers, clear glass, tin cans, and plastics. We've always been eliminating papers anyway. They were never in the waste stream, so to speak. And so what you have left is plastics and glass and tin cans, and there's really not that much tonnage there to speak of. If we'd been putting papers in all along, I think you would have seen a substantial drop. But right now, we've been watching it for the past 3 or 4 months. We're really not seeing a big drop. I don't know if we're just getting more trash in, and you know, I'm just really amazed that it hasn't dropped more. But I don't know what the answer is to that.
Plastic doesn't do much.
No, it doesn't. And you know, glass is a little bit of volume there, but not much.
Perhaps just a sidelight on that particular note, however, is that in a recent memorandum that we received from Regional Waste Systems, although performance has varied widely among the various sites and towns with the drop-off recycling issue, apparently Cape Elizabeth has had the most active and heaviest containers with 25 pulls totaling 76.44 tons, which is an average weight of 3.06 tons per pull. With our curbside recycling, so at least within the county, we are doing super. And please, anyone listening, keep up the good work, because the recycling is going to make a difference. And I'm optimistic we can hit the hopeful reductions by 94. I do see the town manager, however. Michael, can you fill us in about how safe the estimate of $43 per ton is?
The originally, Chuck Fauchet, who's the executive director of Regional Waste System, suggested that we budget a $5 a ton increase, which would bring it up to $45. I spoke to Chuck about a good month ago now, and he indicated to me that that they were getting some direction and feeling from their board, particularly with the new towns coming in, that they might try to hold it at $40 a ton. That was actually when I was reinstating a position in the budget, that was one of the last things I changed was, well, I'll take a chance. At this point, I still have not received their draft budget. I don't think the Regional Waste Board has received one. And, you know, it's nice to, you know, try to lower it and say, let's take a chance, it'll be 40. We did that last year, and we ended up, it was only because we had budgeted extra money for demolition material that we had enough. I think as you look at this particular account item, you know, we're already going $2 under what they said we were going to. Plus, I think we've had a very optimistic assumption there in terms of when the demolition project will get underway. Optimistic in terms of with that budget assumed it's going to be very, very late in the fiscal year. If it's earlier, we're going to have we're going to be in trouble. I noticed they had their first meeting with the Gorham Planning Board this past weekend, or this past month, and it went fairly well. So it might get through the process fairly quickly. And you know, some of it doesn't require a whole lot of work. So I'd be very hesitant to reduce it any further than 43, even though 43 is chancing it.
Thank you.
I talked to Lester John yesterday. They had a meeting the other night, Thursday night. He told me they were down to 41.50. That's what they were thinking about at this point. Now we see if it might change one way or the other. With the building, we think it's going to change that much.
If it was 41.50 billion, would that be through the fiscal 92 year?
Yes.
Yes, it would be.
This point of year, yes.
But last year they told us $40 a ton? Mm-hmm. No, 35.
Mm-hmm.
And it came in at 40, so.
I didn't mention that to change the figure, but I'm just saying that's what they're talking about. But you spoke about the recycling that they have, the people recycling. It still costs you money. They're not selling that stuff. They have to pay people to take it away after they haul it over.
They just got to create a market. That's the problem.
They create a market, so it's still costing the people money to have it. Recycling them, but if it's a market, then it's going to be costly.
They also had another report we got from them this week, because they're having a meeting next week, and they're thinking of starting to have us pay for the cost of hauling the recyclables over to Regional Waste. We haven't budgeted that. You know, right now they set up this program so they would haul it, and now they're saying, well, let's let the municipalities haul it. It's a meeting they're having them.
And I could add a little something to that, Lester said, and I think it would be good for Cape Elizabeth to have that done. It's something like $25 for Cape Elizabeth, but some of these online communities are costing them $100 to bring those rigs in and for them, so it would be a benefit to Cape Elizabeth to do that.
But we'd have to pay for it out of the $43 a ton allowance, you know, out of that account somehow. What Debbie just handed out is going back to the roadway drainage improvement account. And what that shows is that the council approved it as presented. And as you look at the as presented, what you ought to be looking at is fiscal year 1991. And that shows X amount for Spermer Road improvements, so much for regular overlay, and $75,000 for Shore Road. So it does look as though you have obligated $75,000 to it. Shore Road shoulder improvements.
In addition to $50,000 the year before, has that already been spent?
The fiscal year 1990 was $50,000 for the Shore Road allocation.
Right.
Yep. So no, it hasn't been spent. So what that would indicate is that out of the balance of $67,219. You've obligated $125,000. Yeah, so it would mean you'd have to take the 67 plus the 75 in this year's budget, and all of that would have to go to Shore Road shoulder improvements before it went to resolving other issues and problems.
Right.
we really need to revisit that. I don't want to get us off schedule right now, but I think...
As you look at that sheet, what happened, the Waterhouse Road one came in higher than anticipated, which has thrown it off.
None of it was expended on Shore Road at all.
And Spurwink Avenue came in, do you have this, do you have to give you a copy?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, Spurwink Avenue also was coming in a little bit higher than that. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Equipment rental.
Okay, equipment rental, same as last year. Uniform rental, the same. Equipment maintenance, the same. Contingency the same. Alarms the same. It sounds like a broken record here.
Don't worry.
Supplies, again, holding the line there. Capital outlay. What I'm proposing for the coming year is to do some painting up there, both on the upper level of the transfer station and below levels. The humidity and weather elements are really raising the devil up there with the paint, and we really need to sandblast that and get that painted to preserve that metal. So that's what that fund is allocated for.
Would our department personnel do that, Bob?
No, we would contract that out. We don't have the sandblast. We don't have the proper sandblasting equipment or the ladders or what have you that it takes to do a job like that, or the painting equipment.
We're contracting out what's sensible to do.
Okay. Do you have any other secret accounts, Bob? I don't know about here. Or giving. Oh, I'm sorry. Carl,
I'm sorry about that. Ask two accounts. Demolition disposal fees.
Yep.
What is that?
That's really an unknown quantity, and we put that in for the past couple of years in anticipation that the regional waste site would come online, but we really do not know how we're going to get our demolition material out there or who would be required to take their material there. So we've put money in there each year anticipating that they would come online, but...
Okay, so that's just been rolled over into...
That's correct.
Been kept in
step. Last year we allocated $20,000 for it. And again, because of the tipping fee went up, we used that money to offset the increased tipping fee costs.
And that's one reason I would want us to lower the proposed tipping fee, because if this does come online and the tipping fee goes down,
Okay, any other comments or questions for our Director of Public Works?
I just had one about the feasibility of closing the transfer station on that long day for 4 hours between 12 and 4.
Which day would that be?
The long day, when it starts at?
Wednesday?
I don't know.
Be Wednesday. Yeah, Wednesday we're open for 11 and a half hours. And,
that's the day.
Yeah, Wednesday is becoming a fairly busy day. You know, we see Monday is a very busy day, and we're closed Tuesday. But Wednesday morning, up until say 1 to 2 o'clock is very busy, and then it picks up again later in the day as people get out of work. So
I was wondering about the 12 to 3:30 ish.
Yeah, I would hesitate about closing it for that shorter time period.
Because Wednesday morning they're lined right up at 10 o'clock.
Yeah, they are. It's very busy.
Very busy.
Yeah.
And you couldn't do that one on back day like it was open earlier. But it does get slow in the afternoon.
Probably the slowest day is Thursday afternoon.
I go on Saturdays like everybody else. I don't know if that's during
the week.
I just
thought
I'd ask that question.
I go during the week,
so
I don't get in the
hump
upset.
I'm going to
take
on trash today.
Yeah, I was going Tuesday.
You're the one that's cutting the chain, huh?
Yeah.
Before we end, Jane, when do you go? Thank you very much, Bob. You have a concluding.
I don't want to follow that one. I guess we go to parks next.
What page?
Account number
640-1001.
We're in the 600s now.
Thank you.
640.
Page six, page 240, perhaps.
222.
222.
I, again, thank you if you ever had to number this by hand before. It's a lifesaver.
Well, they were numbered by computer last year, so, although we're, but there were some missed and
this year
not
was
readable. I just had one maybe last sort of follow-up question to the whole issue of the equipment operator being a lost position. Let me just ask it this way. Given the extraordinary cut in the budget of about 26% over last year's budget, if there are not major changes made with respect to the overlay situation, that $20,000, the $8,000 less in sidewalk repairs, is it conceivable that given the less materials we would have to work with during fiscal year 92, that person's loss would be less painful in the sense of perhaps being able to cross shift personnel as equipment operator to people actually in the field? Is that at all possible to help minimize that loss?
Unfortunately, the things that we're reducing, say sidewalk replacement, is something that we contract out. So we don't have any personnel there unless we come in and do the landscaping repairs afterwards. Paving is contracted out. Roadway and drainage improvements are contracted out. And so really what it comes down to is that you're missing that person to do the snow plowing and your regular work, but your big reductions are all in areas that are privately contracted.
I was afraid of that. Okay. Let's go to parks.
Full-time payroll, reflecting a 5% increase and also a step increase, a final step increase for the parks equipment operator. Part-time payroll.
Bob, on that full-time payroll, again, unfortunately, it comes out to 6, and we being concrete today, why does it keep getting round up to 6? Is it
He's entitled to a step increase plus a 5% pay increase. So as a result, the net raise is probably slightly around 6%.
Okay.
Part-time payroll, as some of you remember in the past, I fought to get my third maintenance worker position into the budget. Last year it was reinstated, and now this year it's being eliminated. We have a lot of duties in the summertime for these college students that come and work with us. Probably, as far as mowing, we probably have over 100 acres of areas to be mowed. And I think people think we probably just take care of Fort Williams Park, but we have all the maintenance in the school areas, cemeteries, and anything that's a municipal property, whether it be the town hall, a traffic island, a little league field, you name it, we mow. And in addition to the full-time personnel, we supplement that with part-time personnel, and sometimes that isn't enough. We have to bring someone down from the highway division to supplement the workforce because they're just getting behind. And there are times when the parks foreman will come to me and say, we're not making it. I said, well, keep up with the areas that people can see, and the visible areas like the library and what have you, but leave the areas that are out back of the school and try to concentrate on those. And in addition to just mowing duties, it's not just a case of running a lawnmower over a lawn. There are grounds maintenance responsibilities, aerating, field lining. During the sports season, we have one person have to take one of those individuals that just lines fields, and it's a very time-consuming process to do that. A soccer field has the goal areas have to be painted out, and it all has to be done by hand, so it's very labor-intensive to do that. And as a result of that, you've got all the areas in Fort Williams that need to be mowed, and not just mowed, but trimmed with a weed whacker. So you're looking at a considerable amount of time to keep things looking good. Again, because of budget constraints, we eliminated that third maintenance worker position to try to hold the line. And again, I'm not in favor of it, but if push comes to shove, this is the way it has to be. But As a result of this, I'm going to have to put someone from the highway division down there more on a regular basis to assist them. So there's a lot of, and we have that large, high-capacity rotary mower, which helps us considerably, but there's still the very tedious work of trimming that takes a lot of time to make things look good. And you have to weed whack around fences and buildings. And it's all something that someone has to walk around and physically do. You can't always get as close to everything with a riding mower, as some of you know, and there's handwork that has to take place.
In the community services budget, there is a line item for fields. I don't know if you've seen.
No, I haven't.
In the school department, these are usually the people who are responsible for having people use those fields. Is there any sort of mutual agreement that this is costing us X, and if you have it in your, not in your heart, but in your budget to return these funds? Community services returns all profit to the town, Michael?
At the end of the year.
At the end of the year.
Or so they use it as a projected revenue in the following year, so that it's less money from taxation.
The hardest times come is in May, before the college students come to work for us, and then at the end of August when they need to go back to school, because you know your grass gets somewhat dormant in August with the dry weather, and then when September comes it starts to grow again, and you have September and October, and we were mowing this year up until the first week of November, and that leaves two people, you know, realistically to do all that work. And again, you've got soccer season that comes up, so you're down to one person, and again we have to supplement with additional personnel from the highway department. So June, July, and August aren't really a problem because we have the additional personnel and the grass isn't growing as quickly. But crunch time is really before and after that.
Any questions?
How did we get into lining the fields and that come with a package of the maintenance?
That back in 1986 when there was a separation. Yeah, there was originally the school department used to maintain all the fields, as some of you know. And there was a splitting up of duties, and that's one of the duties that we were delegated to. It's a, like I say, it's a very time-consuming process, and it takes a lot out of the regular work day that we could be doing something else.
I don't think that we ought to take a look at that. They ought to be able to do that. They ought to be some students coming in and display and
we tried it.
Or something like that to do that if they was asked to do it.
We went through it with them once and
twice. Actually, twice I tried it again this past summer, yeah. And felt that it would help us. And I talked with Keith Weatherby, the athletic director, and he was doing the field lining for the baseball diamonds. And Keith ended up doing it himself and not delegating it to coaches. And they had to use our equipment to do it, and there was a question of them putting the equipment back at the end of the day and then issuing keys, and it just didn't work out as good as I'd hoped it would, so we took it back.
But coaches in general take the position that they're not paid to do that.
I know that. I understand. I've heard them say that before. They usually done it in the past, even though they're not paid to do it.
There are a lot of good things about the past, though.
Yeah, a lot better than it is now, I'll tell you that. If Kevin was back here, then we could delegate him.
My suggestion was, as we bill $18 an hour to cover the cost for mechanics, that there could be something set up so that there would be a bill presented to their field advisory committee or to community services or to whomever is using that to pay it. Community services can raise money through revenue through fees, and if it costs a dollar more so that when the kids are out there playing, you know, on those fields, and that, you know, built into their fee, and that can reimburse this account so that you can have money to do some of these other things that shouldn't be cut, I would like to see that explored.
It's one thing, you know, as we look at the one town concept, there are a million different things we could be doing to be building back and forth. You know, they would send us a bill for the maintenance of this building, which they maintain. We would send them a bill for the item you just suggested. They would send us a bill for processing payroll checks. We would send them a bill for you know, moving their school bus out of the way or whatever. I think that the whole purpose of the one-town concept is it comes from the same taxpayers, unless there's really a benefit because of the state funding formula to charge it to one side. We ought to avoid all that bookkeeping and just recognizing that taxpayers are taxpayers and going to pay for it one way or another, and let's not have a whole lot of administration. And that's been the theory. And it, we look at it from time to time to be very sure that we're not missing out on any state subsidy. And looking at it, you know, we can identify things. If we had it on the school side, we'd get subsidized. The concern is if we push that too much, then they're going to come back at us and say, well, where is the trade-off because they're doing the town payroll? Where is the trade-off because they're doing the town bills? And, you know, my, and maintain this building. Actually, when we look at the whole thing, we think it comes out pretty well even. And that we have found, for the most part, the places where it's best for one side, if you find the expression, the other side, to be doing it, is doing it. And, you know, we're trying to, if you pardon the pun, draw the lines. If we don't always succeed, it causes a lot of strong feelings at times, but, you know, we do try to avoid drawing the lines when it comes to getting productive work done.
Well, I'm just going to make a suggestion that when we look at a 5% budget tax increase, that maybe we don't look at 5% at last year's amount, and you know, maybe the municipal side needs more money than 5%, and maybe the school doesn't need 5%.
That's an entirely different issue from the.
Well, if I'm saying,
who does what, you know, in terms of.
Well, no, I think it, I see it as the same issue. I mean, if they're doing services that are coming out of what we see as the municipal budget that the schools benefit by, then I think the trade-off should be a dollar amount, whether it's an accounting or a known figure, and just add that back somehow. I'm very sad about all of these cuts, and I'm just really trying to make the right people pay.
It's off the subject, and please bear with me, Councilor Crilly, but you made a comment about their maintaining this building, and yet we have to move here out of our own budget for this building.
Yes.
How do you?
They pay the custodian salary. We pay for building repairs. We give them free rent.
All right. So
yeah, it's if you keep going back and forth, it's, you know, plus one, minus one, plus one. Just one other comment, as long as we're off the subject. Debbie has ordered lunch, and some of you ordered hot sandwiches, and they're going to be ready at down at the Good Table at 12:15 at the latest. So what I would suggest is that at some point you break, and then Bob come back a little bit after lunch. I know he's not going to be thrilled, because otherwise it's going to take until about 12:30 to. Because you still got sewer and Riverside Cemetery with Bob after Parks.
I got one thing on this. The trouble, the whole deal that we sit here about lining the fields.
Yeah.
We'll sit here and pay a guy $10-$12 an hour plus benefits. But then we say, let somebody else do it for free. But we won't even give a high school kid $5 or $6 to do it. This is where I think we get broke down. I think there's kids over there would like to earn a few bucks. And if they were paid for it, then we turn around and look for them to do it for nothing.
So why don't we try to at least finish up with parks before our break, and then we can come back to sewer and Riverside Cemetery.
Just one more thing on part-time payroll. I have adjusted the hourly rates that we pay these individuals to bring them up to more realistic levels. So traditionally, we're paying these personnel five and a quarter an hour, and we just weren't attracting the proper people to fill these jobs. So there is more than a 5% pay increase for those individuals to reflect a more realistic hourly wage. And those are in line with what other municipalities are paying part-time help.
Bob, I have a question on that, actually. Are we paying a first-year park ranger and a third-year park ranger the same hourly wage?
The people that are in the positions right now, I'm anticipating that they're coming back, and one has worked 4 years for us, the other has worked two. So they're proposed to be. We've had a pay scale. We used to have a pay scale for part-time people, but We've really kind of gotten away from that. But if we had a new person come in, obviously we wouldn't pay them the same rate as we would to someone who's been there 3 or 4 years.
What I've seen on a handout from the manager, I believe, is that there had been different hourly amounts for parks maintenance and park rangers. And this year I see everybody in park maintenance at the same, two of park maintenance on the same third year person, the second year person,
right,
both at 6:30.
Right.
And the rangers both at 6:50. Am I? That's
right. The rangers have both been there about the same time period. I think one has one more year of seniority than the other. And there's a little differential between themselves and the maintenance workers because they really require some public relations skills, and it's a little bit more of a skill.
Yeah, I didn't know how much of a tenure discrepancy there was.
There's not, it's like a year.
A year, so. Okay, thanks.
Overtime, number of hours is being held the same. It just reflects the 5% pay increase. Telephone, again, has been reduced slightly. Just because the monthly charge was budgeted up just a whisker too high. Power has been reduced just because the demand usage hasn't been there. Water and sewer is being increased slightly. We have a new water service, a seasonal water service down at Lyons Field, which we use to flood the skating pond, and that $300 increase is just to reflect that. And that's a seasonal account. We don't pay for that all year round. We'll have it discontinued probably at the end of this month. Toilet rental the same. Uniform rental the same. Equipment maintenance the same. Alarm service the same. Gasoline showing a slight increase. Heat showing a slight increase. And that's just because propane costs have gotten a little bit higher. Minor equipment and miscellaneous supplies, again, being held the same. Diesel fuel, a slight increase. Capital outlay, this request is to update the alarm panel at the Parks Maintenance Building. We've been spending a little bit more maintenance dollars on the past couple of years. It was hit by lightning here in the past year, so they've really recommended the people to do the maintenance for us that we update the panel and modernize it slightly. So that's what that proposals for.
I know this budget, your figures was put together a lot earlier, but I bought propane just 3 days ago for $1.47.
Okay, maybe it's gone down, but that was the price that they, we were paying back in January.
I agree with that, because it's gone down from $1.50 to $1.47.
I hope it is.
So, could be revisited.
Bob, are you still on capital outlay?
Yes.
Okay. I'm wondering, just because I can look carefully, if there was anything else scheduled for you this year in that account that you have to put in because of...
No, we're all set on our mowers. I mean, we traditionally like to have budget, say, $2,000 for minor equipment. Mm-hmm. One of the items that I was looking at was a sweeper, either a walk-behind sweeper or a sweeper that would be mounted on one of our tractors to sweep sidewalks with. Mm-hmm. But I eliminated that as a budget request.
Okay.
Parks improvements, this is the account we purchase all our lime and fertilizer and grounds maintenance materials from. I've reduced it by $3,000 again to hold the line on the budget.
What's the condition? There's been one field that needed some extra tender loving care or something, one of the newer fields.
We have one field that I would call a marginal field, and that's the field that's encompassed in the track area. And we've applied a number of nutrients to it. We've watered it on a regular basis, but because of the sub-base material that's in there, we just are not getting a good growth of grass out of it. The sub-base is a mixture of clay and loam together. The problem is that the clay is hardened up and none of the nutrients are getting down into the sub-base. And we've been told that it's really never going to be a super-duper field, and you know, we're trying through aeration and reseeding to bring it back, but it's never going to be as good as some of the other ones.
That's soccer field?
That's correct.
Are there any other fields that have that kind of a similar
problem? No,
that's the only real problem. Because I know some of the other fields are going to be the best in the state.
Right.
Too bad we have one that's not up to par for those.
We would have to completely reframe that for the second.
Well, at some point, I mean, that clay just shouldn't be in that subbase. I mean, really, you should, to build a field, you should use 8 to 12 inches of nice, fine, sandy loam. And when you put that clay in there, it is just hard as a rock. I mean, you can barely dig a hole in that field. And that means that the root structure is not getting down as deep as it should be, and it creates a whole host of problems.
Is that part of the specs, do you know?
Yes, it was.
It was? Who recommended that?
That was before my time.
Must have been an engineer, wasn't a farmer.
They had soils analysis done early on, and what it's a very gravel, you know, it's a gravel pit right next door. It's very gravelly and sandy. And what the soil test showed was that any water that put on it would run right through all the way to the Spurwink Marsh before it did any good. So what did they do to compensate for that? They decided to put this impermeable barrier, and you know, nice try, but that didn't work either. It you know, just like it shouldn't have been sawed.
I found it for a few years. I'm not sure.
Yeah. Last but not least, the port improvements.
Maybe the manager, defer to him on this account.
Yeah, this account is proposed to be reduced in half, and at one point I was even looking at a further reduction. However, I did bring it back to this level because we do have the free services of the National Guard this coming year in order to help develop parking lots and some other improvements that are in the Fort Williams Master Plan that was recently adopted. The design alone of the parking lots for the parade ground, for the central lot, as well as to get the one for Portland Headlight done, we opened bids yesterday and it came up to $10,660. In addition to that, we're going to need to be paying for gravel and landscaping and some construction monitoring, which isn't included in that. We kept that separate, not knowing with the National Guard how much it would be. We also kept separate meeting attendance, and some of those things, you know, need to be through different committees for approval. So that's the priority of the committee for these funds is the routine replacement of flags and that sort of thing that has to be done every year. And then beyond that, it would be to get the materials and plans that the National Guard is going to need for the volunteer work that they're going to be doing for us.
How has the Fort Williams Committee responded to this?
I had set them up for a smaller amount, and in the end they were a little pleased that it had reached back to this amount. I was talking about 10,000 at one point, and then the National Guard obligated it, you know, agreed to help out, and then I thought, you know, we can't, you know, if we've got someone willing to do that work for us at no cost, we ought to be in a position to take advantage of it.
That's your strategy.
That's the strategy. That's right.
Have you heard anything more about that guard unit's potential call up?
No, it's, you know, they're an engineering battalion, and the sense is that most of the rebuilding that's going to need to be done will be private sector work. There's a lot of companies looking for opportunities, and that's
I would heard word on the street about them possibly having to go over after.
Yeah, I think that's pure conjecture, but you look at, you know, reading, you know, some of the other newspapers outside of the local one, and it's fairly clear that the private sector sees has some significant opportunities.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to make sure I understand this. What we're seeing for Fort Williams is routine replacement and maintenance of small items.
Yes.
And the one big issue would be the three parking lots.
Every year, year in and year out, we spend $5,000 or so for all of the new signage, all of the little things that come up. You know, we get a report from insurance that this needs to be done, and I think, you know, the 90-acre park, you've just got to recognize that you run into those expenses. This year, a really terrific thing that came out of this account was John Berry and Bruce Kempton built, how many new picnic tables?
24.
Built 24 new picnic tables, you know, because they weren't as busy helping out with snow. And, you know, we just paid for the materials there, and that came out of this account. And those are not only going to the fort, but a couple of them are probably going over to 1226 Shore Road for the backyard, and we'll get a lot of use out of it. Well, perhaps at this point, it's a good time to break. I'll thank you, Bob, for the presentations thus far. Looking forward to resuming at 1 o'clock on sewer and Riverside Cemetery. Bob Sewer, 99% of the funds into the water district and debt service. Do you really want him here?
There's just a couple accounts that you may have questions on that I could probably go over in about 5 minutes, so.
Let's do it. I hate to tie him up.
Just don't complain when all your food is cold.
That's fine. Call the town.
No, let's do it.
Okay, let's be lay it.
Down the hole the cheese.
Let us, quickly then resume.
Okay. Full-time payroll, again, reflecting a 5% pay increase. So overtime payroll is reflecting a reduction because we're just not having the sewer call-outs that we had in the past. Skip over employee benefits. Uniform rental, staying the same. Sewer line maintenance, this, again, is a dedicated fund that we've been depositing money in each year to pay for minor sewer work that comes up and to go into a fund that if we have to have a minor project that we don't need to borrow for it.
It's really the renewal and replacement fund that I speak of.
How much is in this fund right now?
That's in a memo at the beginning. Which stood at $417,885 as of June 30, 1990. This will bring... However, we're using a lot of that to help fund the sewer budget because of the 20% increase in the district assessment. That's going to bring it down to about $263,000 during this year.
I'm wondering if this is going to help make any sense to propose any cuts. You'll say no.
You're not talking the general fund. This is the sewer fund.
This is the sewer, right.
I could go on for half an hour on that topic.
Don't. Okay.
We can discuss it.
In terms of the general sewer fund and where it's
why don't we just let Bob present what you need to present, and we can come back and resume with this at 1.
Okay. Contingency, again, the same. I'll skip over the other accounts. Small account for gasoline. And that's really about it as far as I'm concerned in the sewer budget that I can relate to. As far as Riverside Cemetery,
page 253.
Count 860-1002 is the part-time payroll. That's for the maintenance worker that works up there and takes care of the cemetery, does mowing and trimming and maintenance. Overtime payroll is for that same individual. Sometimes there are weddings that occur after his regular workday, which is 7 to 3:30. And if there are weddings, say, on Sunday, we have to bring someone in to park vehicles and assist with pedestrian movements up there. And that's been reduced from last year.
Is there an offsetting revenue for that?
Yes.
Okay. Consulting services, that's for Sharon Murray, who takes care of the lot allocations up at the cemetery. Miscellaneous supplies being held the same. And there's about it, I guess. There is a request for capital outlay, and I guess the manager would probably give an explanation of that.
Would you want to talk about capital outlay after lunch?
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Bob.
Very good.
We will, for anyone watching, on the cable channel, we will be breaking at this point and resuming the workshop at approximately 1 o'clock. Thank you very much.
His input to the sewer and Riverside Cemetery account. I think it would probably be helpful, however, to redo those accounts right now with some further input from the town manager. So I will direct us to page 241 of our booklet to begin this afternoon's work. Mr. Manager?
The sewer fund is not directly affected by the general fund and by the property tax. It's mostly dependent on sewer user fees. There are two major components to this budget. One is the assessment that is paid to the Portland Water District. That is budgeted at $900,000 out of a total budget of $1.3 million. The second component is debt service
at $383,337. You add those two factors together, and you get $1.28 million out of $1.31. So you can see it's, those two items alone constitute 98% of this budget. The Quilton Water District assessment, which is the largest one, when we received their assessment back in late December, it provided for an increase of about 20.4% in their assessment. We asked them to go back and look a little bit more at some of their costs. They did. They came back with a 20.3% increase in their assessment. Some of that is for a program that they hope to accomplish on Campion Road on the interceptor line that goes through there to repair some of the catch basins. This past week, as a result of your workshop Monday night, I sent a letter to Joe Taylor, the general manager of the district, asking them to better justify that particular project. You got that letter, copies of it? But anyway, the problem is when you have one item that is about 80% of the budget, 75% of the budget, which is the Fulton Water District assessment, and that goes up 20.3%, that obviously has an impact on sewer user fees. So what I'm proposing to the council is that we increase sewer user fees by 5%, which would bring in $50,000 in income. As you look at this budget, however, the cost is up $121,779. What I'm proposing beyond that is to utilize some of the funds from the renewal from the sewer surplus account in order to help fund this. Obviously, you know, we can't withstand any more than a 5% increase. Even that, it will be extremely difficult. But you know, that's essentially the highlights of the sewer fund budget. Each year, the cost of debt service will be going down slightly. But the Fulton Water District assessment, we've seen a very large increase. And I should make one final mention, is even this Fulton Water District assessment assumes that there won't be an increase next January 1st, and the fact that there might even be a little bit of a decrease. If you look at the amount we're currently paying, it would be at an annualized amount of $924,000. I've only budgeted $900,000, which is an intent to really put the pressure back onto the district, saying, this is what we have, this is it. Next year, you actually have to lower that assessment. And conceivably, they should be able to, because they won't be doing that project next year. And I think that message really needs to get to them, because the sewer user fees in this community are, as we all recognize, already high.
When was our last increase? How long ago?
Last year, 5%.
It was 5% last year, too?
Yeah, and then it was about 3 years before that.
Well, we had the big increase, the double.
When the water district changed their accounting process?
Yeah. On the revenue side, which I believe is at the end of page 250. This shows projected increases in sewer user fees, including the 5% assessment of about $60,000. The school sewer charge would also go up 5%, a little over $3,000. The amount from the general fund would be decreased by $20,000. That's, again, trying to keep the general fund balanced. Sewer investment income would be down about 14%. That's because of lower interest rates. And overall revenues would be up $41,000 because of the rate increase. However, you know, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, the budget is up $121,000. The difference of $70,000, is that right? Off the top of my head, would be met through use of the surface. That's the sewer fund.
Okay, well, we certainly had the input from Mr. Malley with respect to full-time and overtime payroll, employee benefits, other line item issues look to be fairly flat from last year, with the exception of the Portland Water assessment. general here. Does anyone have any particular questions or need of clarification on any of the other items?
I do.
Please.
Page 248, the sewers industry cost, Michael, you've increased that by $5,000.
That's correct.
I just said I wanted to know why it's going to be that much more expensive to collect taxes.
It's essentially because we really haven't been recognizing the expense that's been there all along. As I, you know, began to look at the amount of time that we spend collecting past due sewer balances in the tax office, the lien expense, the extra postage, the amount of time that I spend on sewer issues, really wasn't, if you run a true enterprise fund or a special revenue fund, you ought to be better recognizing those expenses. This is an intent to do that. This is listed as a revenue in the general fund. It's part of the miscellaneous revenues, R03.
So it's really coming from another account of overall expenses, overall administrative expenses that you've been incurring in the past, and now you've just identified it.
That's right.
Really for this particular job.
That's right.
I think we are
confused. What is the assessment that we pay to them?
$77,000 a month currently.
But what does that include?
That includes the operation, maintenance, and debt service of the Southern Cape Elizabeth Treatment Plant. It includes maintenance of all of the pump stations throughout the community. It includes the operation, our proportionate share of the South Portland Treatment Plant operation and maintenance. It includes our proportionate share of the South Portland Treatment Plant. I think, you know, the real scary thing about a 20% increase is that a good part of their budget is for debt service for that treatment plant over in Spurwick Avenue. So if you look at, you know, that's a fixed cost, that means, in effect, say 30% of the budget, 40% of the budget, that, and that stays flat, that understates the effect of all the other increases that you're seeing. And I've had a couple of discussions with the district about this, and I think that the letter that went out to them this week, you know, really indicated that, if they're going to do that Campion Road project, they feel it's necessary that they ought to get other bids for it, contract it out, for to make sure that it's competitive. Because what they do otherwise is they charge, thank you, Billy, they charge all of their time off to our account. And if they're not paying the bill, there isn't an incentive to make it productive. Or if, you know, they're not having, they could be looking for things to charge off to a particular account because of the way the system's set up. That's why I think we really ought to encourage them to bid that out. Because, you know, we could pay a far less bill than if they had their own crews do it and charge it to us.
When they were doing some sort of work, it was infiltration, whatever it was, along the South Portland Cape Elizabeth property line through the wetlands.
Yes.
There were an awful lot of people supervising and not working. And so we were being charged for all those additional bodies.
Is that correct? And we want to make sure that that's avoided.
Jane, did you have a clarification?
Yeah, no, not a clarification, but just a comment on the contribution to the sewer fund from the general fund is decreasing again this year.
Down to $80,000.
Right. And I'm just trying to work out what the percentage of that is, because when the new sewer was connected, when the Southern Sewer went online, I think with the council had taken a position then that the contribution from the general fund would be up to 10% and around 10%. We're now getting down under 7%.
That's a 20% reduction this year in the amount that's being provided. It, it's 80,000 out of 1,300,000. So that's about 6 to 7%.
I mean, that is a policy decision that we ought to at least talk about.
Be real.
Should take a look at that. It should be the 10%. This is what we.
Do we want to revisit this issue? I mean, in terms of the possibility of increasing the allocation.
Just a caution. If you went to the 10%. You'd having to be adding $50,000 to the general fund budget, which if you keep within your 5%, then you need to find other compensating reductions.
No, I just think that it is a policy change. We should have a discussion on it.
on, a vote on.
I think we have an accompanying policy discussion about the percent of increase, if any, similar years, I think.
Well, every year, Councilor Jordan's predictions become truer and truer.
Thank you.
Which one's that?
On track for all.
Well, in terms of where the sewer situation is going, in terms of expense to the town and the citizens. Other particular input, let's revisit that. All right, that would bring the sewer fund, sewer situation to a close for the moment and head on to Riverside Cemetery, account 860, page 253.
There are two items that I would like to hit on this particular account. They are on page 255 and the final page. 255, it's proposed that the Riverside Cemetery also provide a contribution to the general fund of $3,000 for the services that be provided. This would provide for the time spent by Deborah Pizzo, Bob Malley, Bruce Kempton, and others on Riverside Cemetery activities. It also pays for the cost of the benefits for the person that's in the 1002 account, because those benefits have always been absorbed by the general fund. Those would now be absorbed and paid for by the Riverside Fund. I have reviewed this with the trustees, and they did approve of this change. The second one is that the trustees asked that the income this year, but excluding the lot sales, but the operating income, the interest income, that whatever amount of that was left after the other expenses were looked at, be devoted into developing a master plan for the cemetery. That amount is just about, I think, $5,020. We're not running out of space right away, but you know, we are getting some, we're using up space all the time in the cemetery. And we are at the point now, we ought to be looking at the total land we own over there, see what is usable in terms of ledge, in terms of setbacks, and in terms of just good space for burial space. I applaud the trustees for their interest in doing this. I think it's something that's desperately needed.
Is that amount just for a plan, or is there any implementation proposed for that?
The suggestion was that to try to make that money go as far as it can. Is that right, Deb? Sounds good.
Okay, we have been already presented with the details from Public Works on the cemetery account. Are there particular questions at this point? Okay, let us bring account 860 to a close at this point. We will not need to revisit this as far as I can tell. Let us proceed to account 160.